So very good afternoon to one and all. So today we have with us Mrs. Pooja Jaiswal Madam from Electrical Department. So she has awarded with B and M.Tech degree from the Rajiv Gandhi University Bhopal, and now she is pursuing PhD from RGTU Bhopal, and she has more than 11 years experience from the VPKB IIT Paramati. Her research area includes solar energy, maximum power tracking, and genetic algorithm. So she has attended workshops from IIT Bombay and has published paper in IEEE International Conference on Energy Efficient Technologies for Sustainability. So I'll request to Jaiswal Madam. So kindly start the next session. So her session is on energy conservation. So now we will proceed. Thank you.
Hello, good afternoon.
Hi, ma'am.
So today we will start, or we will see the energy conservation process and its importance.
Madam, are you sharing something? Okay. Screen is visible now.
Now, we will see what is the energy conservation. Myself, Pooja Jaiswal, and I'm assistant professor from Department of Electrical Engineering. What is energy conservation? In a simple words, energy conservation is the efforts made to reduce the consumption of energy by using less of an energy services. In other words, we can say the gap between electrical energy supply and the demand is continuously increasing. To bridge this gap, we need the help of energy conservation. Now, what energy conservation includes? So the first thing is, it is a new source of energy. How I can say that it is a new source of energy? Because we are saving the energy. As we are saving the energy, it is equivalent to the production of energy. Why I am saying it's a new source of energy? The plant efficiency where electricity is generated is in between 30 to 85%. Means at the output, we are getting a one unit of electrical energy. At the same time, output is one unit of energy. If the efficiency is 50%, so input is double. Whatever input we are getting only half unit as an output. So saving a one unit is equivalent to the two units of generation. Is I audible? Students, please reply me on the chat box. Am I audible? Okay, thank you. So let's continue. So it's a new source of energy. So next is environmental friendly. We are saying energy conservation is environmental friendly because we are saving the energy. If we are saving the energy, means there is a no production. As there is a no production of electrical energy, there is a no pollution. So it is an environmental friendly. Next is, it is cost effective with a short payback period. Definitely it is a short cost effective because you don't need anything for energy conservation. So it's a cost effective. As you are saving a one unit, means you are saving approximately 10 rupees. So it's a cost effective with a short payback period. Next, it is modern investment, because if you will save the energy today, you can utilize, you can enjoy this unit energy later. So it is a modern investment. Now, the scope of energy conservation. There is a good scope in a various sectors. So the first sector which we are considering here is agriculture. Now, many of us coming from this agriculture background, and we know that in a agriculture field, the most important part is our pump set. Every agriculture field having a pump set for supplying the water. So if we use a proper design and operation, means design as well as operation is important here. If we design a proper pump with a proper consideration and its operation is proper, then we can save up to 20 to 30% of your energy. So agriculture is a main area where we are utilizing the electrical energy. So here, with a proper design, you can reduce the consumption. If you reduce the losses, means you are utilizing the more electrical power, and it is a form of energy conservation. Now next, in a industries. Now, in a industries, there are many industries which are small scale. Some are very old industries. Okay, so there is a lack of a skilled and technical management in a old industries. In a some industries, there is a less capital. So they ignore the important aspect of energy conservation. So what can we do to increase the energy conservation? We can use a proper design of a machine first. Second, we can do a proper maintenance. Next, we can replace our old machines, less efficient machines, with a new advanced machine with good efficiency. And now the government of India has passed an act in 2001, that is Electricity Conservation Act. So now that act has it's an important act for the energy conservation, and each industry need to follow the all rules and regulations. So what they have made a rule, they have made a rule, if any industry who is consuming more than 500 kilowatt of power should carry out the technical audits. So there should be a technical audit on a yearly basis or in a 6 month basis. So by these methods, we can conserve the energy. And most important is domestic application. Now, in a see, nowadays, everyone having all the facilities in their homes and all the domestic appliances we are using. So when we are purchasing any appliances, we should see the rating, star rating on the equipment, whether it is a efficient or not, energy efficient or not. So what it means, we should purchase the appliances with good rating and efficient motors. Now, there are the various appliances which is available with a very low cost. But if you will buy a low cost appliances with inefficient motors and the circuitry, then you have to pay much more later as a form of electricity bill. So these three are the places where we can do the energy conservation. Now, to understand the energy conservation, we need to understand the Bureau of Energy Efficiency. Now, what is the Bureau of Energy Efficiency? In India, in a governmental India, has prepared an act in 2001, which is known as the Energy Conservation Act. That has been established in 2001. Later, under this, Government of India has set up a Bureau of Energy Efficiency. So, what is the purpose of this Bureau of Energy Efficiency? Its main objective is to reduce the energy intensity and utilization for Indian economy. It simple means Bureau of Energy Efficiency observes the utilization of electrical energy and how efficiently we are utilizing that energy. So it takes overlook or it observes all around the India what process is what processes are followed by the industries, by the agriculture community, and by the your home appliances in a buildings. Now, National Energy Conservation Day. It is celebrated on 14th December. The day has been, this day celebration has been started from the 1991. So this Bureau of Energy Efficiency under the Ministry of Power celebrate the National Energy Conservation Day. So what we do on this special day? So in this special day, BEE organize. BEE means Bureau of Energy Efficiency organize the various competitions like debate competition, slogan competition, poster competitions, energy awareness programs and training programs. Okay, so this day is important because it is remembered as a National Energy Conservation Day. Now, there are the many initiatives taken by the governor to promote the energy efficiency and energy conservation. Now, what it means? The government of India have a number of bodies which are, those are working for the energy conservation. So first is standard and labeling by the Bureau of Energy Efficiency. Means Bureau of Energy Efficiency is making the standards which will be followed by everyone where electricity is utilizing. Next is Energy Conservation Building Codes. Now its main purpose is, means there are some structure and there are some rules and regulations which should be followed when you are making a building. Under this, the building design is considered, which should include a proper design strategy so that the building will get the proper air and the light. There should not be any shadow effects. The location and construction. This comes under the Energy Conservation Building Codes point. Now the third is National Mission for Enhanced Energy Efficiency under NAPCC. What is NA? N for National, A for Action, P for Plan on Climate Change. What it means? When BEE are forcing us to use the electrical energy efficiently, at the same time, it is forcing us to consider the climate change conditions. These all things are very important because when you are producing the electrical energy, you should consider the climate change condition also. Because when we are producing the electrical energy from the coal or from the oil or from the nuclear power plant, so there are the substances which are increasing the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. As carbon dioxide is increasing in the atmosphere, it is creating the pollution related problem. So NMEEE control on the climate change. Next is School Education Program by BEE and NCERT. Under this, government is providing the trainings, some courses, and some titles in the school, in the syllabus for the students. Next is human resources development. Human resources development means we are giving the training to the humans, and they are developing and making the people aware about the energy conservation. Next, sixth number is promotion of energy efficient LED bulbs, Ujjwala scheme. Under the Ujjwala scheme, the government is giving the awareness about the LED bulb. If you are using the LED bulb, it is consuming the less energy and giving you the higher energy power. Now, LED bulbs produces less heating effects. So, LED bulbs are more efficient in terms of energy as well as in terms of the global warming. And last one is promotion of electrical vehicles. Under the Act of 2013, the Indian government has decided to start the electrical hybrid vehicle on road as a government vehicle till by year 2020. So in the next 2 or 3 years, your all ST means buses will be replaced by diesel buses will be replaced by this electrical hybrid buses. Now, this is quite interesting part. If you have not, this will give you the brief idea about how you can reduce your electricity bill and how you can help in energy conservation. So now we will see the electrical energy conservation in day-to-day life. So the first point is, what is watt? What is watt? Now, a watt is a unit of measurement of power. So what it mean and why we are studying is, so see, when you go to the market to buy a bulb or a light, what you say, I want a 40 watt bulb or a 60 watt bulb. So this watt means it is a measure of power for the electrical equipments. So let's assume how to calculate the energy consumption. See here, it is important. It is watt hour per day. So means device wattage into hours. For how many hours you have used that equipment. Let's have an example. 60 watt bulb is used for 8 hours. 60 watt bulb is used for 8 hours. So total watt hour will be, see here, 60 multiplied with 8. It is 480 watt hour. Means this much energy is utilized by this 60 watt bulb if you are using it for one day for 8 hours. Now next is device usage in kilowatt. So what you will do? Total watt hour divide by 1000. So you will get a unit kilowatt hour. See, I repeat, 60 watt bulb used for 8 hours. So it will be 480 watt hour. What I will do? I will divide this by 1000. So its unit will become kilowatt hour. Now, the device usage in kilowatt hour is 480 divided by 1000. So this is kilowatt hour. Now next is approximate monthly usage. Means how much energy you have utilized. So the daily usage is 480 divided by 1000 kilowatt hour multiplied with 30. So in a 1 month, a single bulb will utilize 14.4 kilowatt hour energy. Is it clear? Is it clear or you want to repeat? Is it clear? So simply what we are doing, we are utilizing the energy. Now in the next few slides we will see how you can reduce your electricity bill by a simple small methods. Okay, so see. Now, see here, there are the number of lamps and bulbs are available in the market. So the types are incandescent lamp, halogen, CFL and LED. So now see here, now we will see the comparison of these four types with respect to lumens. What is lumens? Lumen is the the light falling on a per unit area. So here 450 lumens, here it is 800 lumens, here 1100 and 1600 lumens. Means this, if I want 450 lumens, then if I am taking an incandescent bulb, then I need to purchase of 40 watt. Simple, see. If I want 450 lumens, then for the incandescent lamp, the rating will be of 40 watt. But for halogen, it will be reduced. It will be only 29 watt. For CFL type bulb, it will be 11 watt. And for LED, it will be only 9 watt. See, if I'm changing the type of a bulb, the power consumption is reducing. See, for 800 lumen, here in an incandescent lamp, there will be a 60 watt. For halogen, it will be 43. For CFL, it will be only 13. And for energy used, it will be 12 watt. So you can observe by this table, if I'm using a LED or CFL bulb, the power requirement will be very less. See here, for 1600 lumens, incandescent bulb require 100 watt. Whereas LED requires only 220 watt. So if I'm using the LED bulb, then my power consumption is reduced by 80%. Now I'm utilizing only 20% of energy. Is it clear? So what happening? See here, if I'm purchasing an incandescent bulb, its life will be only 1 year. Halogen bulb, its life will be 1 to 3 years. If I'm buying a CFL bulb, its life is 6 to 10 years. And LED bulb life is 15 to 20 years. Of course, the price of incandescent bulb is very less, maybe 10 or 15 rupees. But if you will observe the energy in terms of money, then here, for let's say an example, the unit cost of one unit is 10. So the bill of incandescent will be 1000. For halogen, 720 into 10 per unit watt. So the bill will be 720. For CFL, the cost will be 23 units into 10 rupees. 230 rupees bill will be there, electricity bill. For 20 watt into 10 means only 200 rupees will be there. Whereas incandescent bulb, the bill will be highest 1000 rupees. Whereas it will be only 200. For over a long period, this LED will save your money, save your energy. Okay. And it will not produce any heating effects in your room. But if you will use incandescent lamp, the area where you are utilizing it, that will be hot. And whereas LED, there will not be no heating effect. Now, what are the other method to conserve the energy for the light? So first important is turn off the light when you are not in that room. Next, paint the wall with white and light shades, which enhance the reflection and consumes less energy. Next, in our offices or in a study table, keep the bulb on the table, not on the back side. It should be on a table in front side of your workplace. Next is remove the dust from the bulb so that you will get the brighter light. Try to get the natural air and the light. Important, avoiding switching on the light during the day. Means don't use the light during the day. One more important thing is, when you say it zero bulb, it is not a zero power consumption. A zero bulb also consume 12 to 15 watt power. So don't use zero bulb in a daytime. If it is on, kindly keep it off. Next is home cooling. So how your home get heat? So through the terrace, it gets 50%. Through the walls, 15%. Through the doors, 30%. And through the floor, it is only 5%. So how can we cool our home without lightning? So what can we do? We can spread gunny bags on the terrace and pouring water on them. In a summer, you can do it and see the difference. You will feel the more cooling in your home if you are spreading the gunny bags on the terrace. Next, saving sheds, west facing windows and wall to reduce the afternoon temperature. Next, in a summer, use sheds or curtains to keep sunlight out, especially in afternoons. Now, it is an important part. Fans and air conditioner. When you will compare fan and air condition, okay? So, in a summer, everyone having a air cooler or a conditioner at their home. So when you will observe that the air conditioner and air cooler, if I comparison two, then air cooler consumes less power than the air conditioners. Air coolers consumes less energy power and makes your room more cooler. Cool. It makes your home more cool. What it means, see, in comparison to air conditioner, air cooler consumes only 1/4 of the electricity bill. And it consumes very less power and gives you more cooling. So if possible, instead of air conditioner, use air cooler. Next, clean the air filters of air conditioner from time to time. Because if there will be a dust, there will not be a proper cooling. So if there will not be a proper cooling, means the efficiency will be reduced. Now, compressor consumes more electricity due to accumulation of the dust on the filter. So this is again the part of dust. Now, what can we do? Another part is switch off the air conditioner half an hour before leaving the room. Because the air cooler or air conditioner keep your room cool for next half an hour. So you can save the energy by that way. Close the windows and doors. It is very common. Next is, now, for the air conditioning, there is a labeling. What is energy efficient ratio, which is mentioned on your air conditioner. If energy efficiency ratio is high, it means your air conditioner is having a high efficiency. Do you know about the star rating? So star rating means, having a high star rating means the machine is more efficient. Similarly, energy efficient ratio, if it is high, it means your air conditioner is highly efficient. Now, it is a very, very important and interesting part. Now, previously, in a conventional fan, we were using the induction motor. Now, that induction motor has been replaced by brushless DC motor. See, now I have made a comparison between BLDC fan and the conventional fan. Conventional fan, which we were using from the last 100 years, approximately. 80 to 100 years. Now, in a power consumption in a watts, the BLDC fan requires only 28 watts, whereas conventional fans use 80 watt power. See the difference. It is 28 and it is 80. Now, daily usage is 10 hours. Let's say energy rate per unit chahiye, not its day. Energy rate per unit, sorry, it should be units. So 10 rupees per unit. Number of the day used 365. So the power consumption of fan per year in kilowatt will be, see, 28 power consumption for how many hours? 10 hours. So it's 28 and it is in a kilowatt hour consumption. See, it is what? 28 into 10. So it will be 280. 280 multiplied with 365 divided by 1000, you will get this term. So the power consumption of the fan per year is 102. Whereas the power consumption of conventional fan is 292. See the difference. It is only 102 and it is 292. It is approximately triple. So bill will be 102 multiplied with 10. So the total bill will be 1022. Here it will be 2920 rupees. So the difference of 2 is 1898. This much rupees you can save if you replace your conventional fan with BLDC fan. It is an important concept here. Conventional fan and BLDC fan. Of course, the cost of the BLDC fan is higher. But if you will compare it for the 2 or 3 years of electricity bill, you will find the BLDC fan is much cheaper than this conventional fan. The conventional fan seems to be, it is available with the low cost. But BLDC fans, over a long period, it saves money as well as the energy. Now see the computers. Now how can you save the energy from the computers? For an example, if a computer runs 24 hours a day, then its total power consumption is equivalent to a refrigerator power consumption. So the important thing is when you are not utilizing the computer, monitors and copiers, then keep your computers and laptops on a sleep mode. By this, you can save approximately 40% of the energy. And don't keep plug into the wall, because if even though the laptops, cell phones, battery chargers are not connected, but still there is a supply of power and there is a consumption of energy. So keep plug off. Refrigerator. In a refrigeration, when you are keeping the foodstuff, first make it cool and then place in a refrigerator. It will save the energy. Don't keep the refrigeration door open, because if you will keep it open, the heat will increase on the refrigerator and it will consume more power. And when you are opening the fridge for some work, then just make half open. It's not required to fully open the door. So if you will making full, what happening? The heat is going in. So in this way, the energy consumption will increase. Important part is clean the backside of the refrigerator 3 to 5 times in a year with a brush and vacuum cleaner, so that there will be a proper flow of air in a refrigerator for the cooling purpose. Now, see, Bureau of Energy Efficient has come with the labeling. You might have seen there is a now labels, 5 ratings, 4 ratings. So these labels are available in the market to identify the which product is more efficient with the same rating. Washing machines. So one, we are saying that try to run the washing machine always on the full load, because if you are running on the half load, then also it is taking the full power. Next is, more power will be consumed if there is a water heater in a machine. Now there are the various machines where automatic water heating is there. So if automatic water heating is there, then it will consume the more power. So what you need to do, take the hot water from outside, keep your cloth in on that water and then utilize it. And most important, when you have a few clothes, don't on your machine. Do it manually. Geysers and the water heater. So what's a geyser and water heater? Simply try to use solar based or gas based water heater for the heating. Water pumps, it is a very, very important part. We should always use an ISI mark motor, because ISI mark motor having a proper design and it requires less operational cost as well as it consumes less power. Next is lubricant pump set regularly, means there should be a proper oiling and maintenance of your water pump. One important point is there, when the water tank is taking, water pumps are taking the water, it may run on the low power factor. So your pump should run on proper or a good power factor. So how can we increase the power factor? We can connect a shunt capacitor. We connect a capacitor on shunt. So the water pump will consume less power. And always use a starter for the motor. Now, standby power waste. This is an important part. Many times what we do, we start the TV and we don't off the main switch. And it stay for whole night. So that is known as a standby power waste. We say that we are not using the TV or cell phone charger plug, but they are connected to the plug. So they are consuming the power, that is known as a standby power waste. So better off the supply and remove the plugs from the, remove the connectors from the plug. And always use a stars, high star TVs and other equipments. Now the most important part is for the energy conservation. As a part of a energy conservation, our institute is a partner of Energy Swaraj Foundation for Energy Literacy Drive. And under this, our institute has received a letter of appreciation for successfully completion more than 500 certificate in the energy literacy drive. In an energy literacy drive, they have taught us how to install a solar panel or how to design your own house solar panel, your own. So that link I will share with all of you as soon as possible. So you all can do that course. So you will be able to design your own solar house. Now, the Center of Excellence, as a part of energy conservation, I'm a coordinator for a solar photovoltaic system design and application Center of Excellence. Now, the activities which we have planned under the COE is various hands-on workshop, seminar, faculty student development program, industrial connections, energy audits, visit, research paper, publication, research proposal submission, project, expert talk, and etc. So what we will do, we will learn everything here under the COE, solar related work. Okay. So thank you. If you have any doubt, you can ask me. If any students have having any doubt, you can ask me. Anyone? No doubt. Okay. So with this, we can say for the energy conservation, we say that energy cannot be generated, it cannot be destroyed. It can be transferred from one form to another. Is it clear? So as a students, you have a lots of a potential, you have a lots of energy. So transform this energy in a positive and optimistic way to serve the society, to serve the nation. Thank you so much.
थैंक्स अ लॉट मैडम. पूजा मैडम, यू आर गिवन on the behalf of all the students of the first year engineering and the staff, I express sincere thanks to Pooja Jaiswal madam, who has elaborated the talk on energy conservation in a very lucid way. She has explained everything very nicely with proper presentations, and definitely we have understood that even though we cannot create energy, we can save energy, and saving of energy is equivalent to producing that energy. Thanks a lot, madam. Further, I would like to give an instruction to our first year students that tomorrow afternoon from 3 to 5 p.m. there is another body which is going to conduct a session on FE induction program, and that is Maharashtra Chamber of Commerce, Maharashtra Chambers of Commerce, Agriculture and Industries. So we have to, they are going to provide, they are going to provide the platform, and attendance of every student is going to be very much important. So with this, I would like to hand over the next session to Pandre sir. Actually, everybody is very much familiar with Pandre sir, and he is a very energetic person from communication skills, and he is going to have one more session today, and he will be elaborating about the exam and so on. So I welcome Professor Nilesh Pandre for the next session.
Hello, good afternoon to all. Am I audible? Yes, thank you. We were talking about telephonic conversation, right? In the last lecture, some of the part of the same has been finished, and the remaining part we are going to complete today. Okay. Placing a calls, right? We have finished it in the last lecture, right? And now just give me some time. Okay, and as we know, telephonic conversation is one of the part of technical English, right? In the last lecture, we had seen, we had talked about the email writing, and now in this lecture, we will be talking about telephonic conversation. Okay, as I have already told you that every day we do use a telephone or mobile phone, but the question that comes to my mind or everyone of us is that do we speak while on the phone with etiquettes? Do we follow some telephonic manners or no? And that is the question that I am going to raise over here and address to. Okay, so in placing the call, what we need to do, state your name along with the name of person who you are calling. Okay, state your name along with the name of the person who you are calling. When you make a phone call to someone, that at the same time you are supposed to share your firstly your name, and then you may say, am I speaking with XYZ? For example, hello, my name is Nilesh, good morning, may I speak with Tejas, or may I speak with Nitin, or may I speak with Mr. Sonavani? So in this way we could set a tone, or we could raise the platform on which we wanna go ahead. Okay, so example, namaste, this is Rahul from Joanita, may I please speak with Miss Lisa? In this way, okay, ask the caller if it is convenient to talk. It is often time we believe that if I'm going to call someone else, that other person is free. It is not necessary that the person would be free for you to receive your call. For that reason, one must check the availability of the speaker. Okay, if you call someone, it is your prime duty to ask him if it is good time to talk to him or her. Okay, otherwise what we do in our daily life, we just call him and we just bombard or enforce our talk on him or her, right? So when you will call someone else, you will say, hello, good afternoon, I'm Nilesh speaking. Is it good time to speak with you, Mr. Rahul or Mr. Sunavani? Is it good time to speak with you? In this way, you will have to take a permission of the speaker, and then you may continue your conversation, right? State your business as politely as clear as possible. Okay, oftentimes the mobile phone is not or telephonic conversation is not for the very long talk. Okay, it is for a very short talk, and you are supposed to share your work or business as soon as possible, instead of prolonging it or instead of extending it for a longer time. What is your business? What is your work? Why have you called them or her or him? You should clear it to that person very immediately. Otherwise, there would not be a curiosity. Use the client's name during the conversation. See, when you call someone else, you are supposed to utter at least two or three times the name of the person to whom you are calling. Suppose if you have called to Mr. John, okay. Then, suppose your conversation has long for 4 minutes or 5 minutes, at least two or three times you should utter the name of Mr. John. What will happen because of this? It will convince to Mr. John that you are very sincere and you are very close to that person. So he might be ready to your question, to answer your question, or whatever the business that you want to get done from Mr. Jones, he will show a green signal to get that work done, to execute that work. Okay, insist on calling back if the connection is faulty. Suppose, oftentimes what we do when we call someone and if there is a connection error, we do not call him or her back. Okay, someone has called you, okay, and suppose there is a no range in your home. So it's your courtesy, it's your prime duty to call the person back, because the problem is with you. The problem is with range from your side. So it is not his or her problem. So what you need to do, you need to call him or her back. Okay, and this shows your etiquettes regarding the telephonic conversation. Ending the call. How will you end a call? Oftentimes, how do we end a call? We just say bye and you put the receiver. Okay, oftentimes we don't say hello, thanks for calling. We don't say such kind of a words. We do not express our gratitude towards the person who has shared his valuable time with you. Okay, so it's your duty to express thanks towards the person who has called you, because he or she might have drawn some his valuable time of his life and share with you. Okay, when conversation is complete, do the following things. One, make sure that the caller has no more queries or message. What happens? Oftentimes we are in a hurry and we are eager to cut the call and resume the next work. Okay, but it should not happen because it shows that the person who is speaking with you has no importance in your life or has no importance in at your end. Okay, so until and unless each and every query and message is fixed, is finished, is solved, you will have to engage the call. Okay, je lages thevaycha nahi call to konacha message query sampat nahi to friend. Okay, right, it means that it shows you are not serious about the call. Theek hai, use goodbye, thank you for calling to end the conversation. How will you end the conversation? By saying goodbye, thank you for calling, see you. Thank you for calling, see you, goodbye. In this way, you will have to say something. At least the person could feel comfortable. Okay, at least you are showing gratitude that someone has given a time to you. Okay, make sure the caller drops down the receiver before you. What we do in our daily life, we often we are very hurried to put the receiver down before the person. What we have to do over here, if you are called by someone else, you will not put the receiver until the person puts it. Do you understand? If someone has called you, you are not supposed to put the receiver by the end of conversation until the next person puts it. Okay. And if you have called, then you may put. Okay. Right. Who is caller? Caller, or who is caller and who is receiver? Receiver will not put the receiver down until caller cuts his or her call. Okay, म्हणजे तुम्ही कधी रिसीवर अगोदर खाली ठेवायचं नाही. This prevents the feeling that you may have cut off them intentionally. What happens? There is a prejudice, or there might be misconception. If you put the receiver immediately, though you have put it because you have a work, but the other person could think that you are ignoring that ignoring him or her. Okay, this kind of a feeling should not be given. It should not be issued from your side. Okay, one thing that what will you do? First of all, by the end of conversation, and when you want to end the conversation, you will say goodbye, thank you for calling, and I would like to be in your contact. Okay, or you may say keep calling me, just you can say. And another thing is that you will not put the receiver before the caller puts it. Okay, that these two things you should take into consideration. How to transfer the call? Okay, suppose if someone has called you your father and you are attending his call instead of a father, and you want to transfer the call to father. Okay, or it might happen with the customer care. Okay, when you call to the customer care, and if you want to speak with the person who is looking after the screen and all these things about the mobile, so you may say that I want to speak with this person. So the other person will say, let me put that person on a call, give me some time. In this way, this kind of a situation is over there. So transfer calls only if you are unable to help the caller, or if the call is meant for the someone else. When will you transfer the call? If you are unable to help the caller, Or the call is meant for your someone else. Suppose you are in the home and suppose what we can say, the milkman has called you. Okay, right. If is it possible for you to handle this call? Or if not, you may call to your parent. Or if that person is saying that I want to speak with your father, you may call. You may transfer the call to father. Otherwise, you try at your level best to answer the call. Ask permission to transfer the calls and explain reason for the transfer. See, ask permission to transfer the call and explain the reason for the transfer. Okay, if you are unable to answer the question, then you will transfer the call to the person, other person. But before starting transferring the call to the other person, you please convince the caller that I am going to transfer the call to someone, because that person will only handle your queries. I am not fit for that. Okay, in this way, let the caller know the name and department you are transferring the call to. Okay, see, when you call to the customer care, okay, regarding the balance issue, regarding the, you know, unnecessary cutting of the account balance, and all these things. Okay, so what happens if your query is regarding particular department? Okay, so the lady will ask you that I am transferring your call to the HR of our company. Please stay on the line. In this way, right? So in this way, you would also use the same language, same kind of things in your daily life. What will happen? It will keep you practicing this kind of a protocols, and then afterwards it will become your habit. Habit will become your nature, and nature will become your personality. In this way, it becomes your personality. Be sure you are transferring the caller to the proper person or department. Okay, if you want to speak with the production department, so suppose you are transferring the call, then you first of all make sure that you are transferring the call to the proper person and proper department. And if you fail to do so, what will happen? You are going to waste your time and the person who has called you. So you may kill the time of three person: yourself, the caller, and the person whom you are transferring the call to. So this is how you are you should save the time of these three person, including you too, these two person and including you. If the caller complains about being transferred, suggest having the call returned instead. Give new party any helpful information before completing the transfer. So if when you are transferring the call, you will share the same information with the caller that I am transferring this call to Mr. XYZ and this department. So please hold on. In this way, never transfer a call more than two times. Please keep in mind that you will not transfer more than two times. What does it mean? It means that you are not suitable over there, because if you do not fix a problem in a single stroke, and you are taking for more than two stroke, it means that you are not fit for that job. Okay, this, and it will irritate the caller. It will kill the time of caller and your too. So try to transfer the call to the exact person and exact department. Know the transfer instructions for the telephone system so that you do not cut off your call. See what happens. Oftentimes, when we transfer the call to someone, we cut the call off ourselves, or the callers. Okay. So you should know that technology first of all. Placing a call on hold. Okay. ऑफटाइम्स आपण म्हणतो बा बोलताना की होल्ड कर फोन होल्ड कर ओके तेच इफ यू वॉन्ट टू यूज द सेम थिंग वेन यू विल एनकाउंटरिंग द सेम थिंग इन कॉर्पोरेट लाईफ हाऊ विल यू से विल यू से टू युअर बॉस दॅट होल्ड करा जरा फोन असं म्हणू शकतो का नो वी कांट से लाईक दिस होल्ड होल्ड ऑन कॉल hold on so for that reason we do have some what we can say expressions and that could be used make sure it's for a good reason if you want to put someone on a hold you should put someone on a hold but the reason should be good otherwise for negligible reasons we could not put a call on call someone put a hold on hold someone okay make sure it is for a good reason second ask permission before placing a caller on hold suppose when you are speaking with your senior and someone has called immediate there is urgent call from your home so will you cut the phone of your senior and will receive the phone call of your family members no you are not supposed to do that before this if you think that it is very urgent you may give this prior permission to your senior that I have a very urgent call from home so may I receive that call and meanwhile I will put your call on hold in this way you can provide the information to the person and then you are ready to receive the phone call from your private phone right otherwise you can't return to the line periodically so if you have put someone on hold you will not put him or her more than 1 minute or one and a half minute okay otherwise we do have you know habit of keeping someone on hold for 2, 3, 5 minutes okay and you are speaking with the other person this should not be the case or here ask callers if they want to continue holding okay if you pass 1 minute then ask the person may I hold you more for 1 minute otherwise you may cut the call and will give surety that you will call him back okay indicate how long delay could be when you want to put someone on hold you should convey the person that I am going to keep you on hold for next 5 minutes next 2 minutes 3 minutes okay and then here the person will decide if he want to stay on the line or he would cut and will call back after 5 minutes it would be depend on the caller so but you should clear the ground on your side offer to call the person back if the wait will be long right when someone is calling you and he is on wait and you think that if you receive his call he will take your 10 minutes and it is not good to keep someone on wait for 10 minutes so you will directly convey the message to the caller that I have a very urgent phone call and I would not be able to finish the call within 10 minutes so I will call you after 10 minutes and ask him to cut the phone in this way never leave a customer on hold for longer than 30 seconds see what is the limit of keeping someone on hold only 30 seconds okay if you keep someone on hold for more than 30 seconds it may irritate him it may give a bad impression of you okay so if you are sidelining someone and you are engaging you are attending someone it means that it is a kind of insult for the other person too so if you want to keep someone on hold you just ask him you may keep him or her on hold for only 30 minutes not more than 30 seconds okay be courteous respectful and professional answering multiple calls when you want to answer at a time multiple calls okay you could see in the picture that you know that lady is handling at a time three or more than three calls okay and when you could not think we could not decide which phone call should be received, which phone call should be refused. At that time, some guidelines, some protocols has been given to you. And what will you do in such a critical situation? Place the first call on hold. Answer the next call. What will you do? Suppose you are attending very first call, and at a time second phone call has come. What will you do? You will place first call on hold and will answer the next call. Complete the second call only if it can be handled quickly. Return to the initial call promptly. Okay. If you are speaking with the caller number one, and suppose caller number two has called you, you will take a permission of caller one and will receive the phone call of two. And the moment you will finish the phone call, caller number two, you will answer the caller number one. You will not ignore that person. Return to the initial call promptly. Provide quality service that meets or exceeds the customer's expectations. Okay. Taking a message. Write a message even if the caller indicates they will call back. Include the time and date. Write legibly. Verify the caller's name, phone number by repeating the information. Include as much information as possible to help message recipient return the call. Sign or initial the message slip. Deliver the message promptly. Taking message. If someone has asked you that, if you have promised someone that I will be calling you after 10 minutes, I will be calling you at night, I will be calling you in the afternoon, you please make it note down, please note it down, and time also, and you should call that person at the same time. Okay, so it will create trustworthiness amongst both of you. See, answering the wrong phone call. Suppose someone has called and it is a wrong phone call. Okay, how will you answer that call? Come on, how will you answer that call? See, inform the caller politely that she reached a wrong number. Suppose someone has called you and you came to know that this is a wrong call. So what will you do? You will politely say to the caller that the person to whom you are calling is not a right person. You have called someone other. Okay, the person who has called by you is not a right person to whom you can speak. This is how you can convince him. Otherwise, oftentimes what we do, we directly cut the phone. Right? If some unknown number is calling to you, what we do oftentimes, we directly cut the call. But instead of directly cutting the call, if you could receive that call and understand what the exact problem of the caller, and then you came to know that this call is not meant to you, then you could see that the person to whom you have called is not the right person to whom you may speak, and you may return. Right? Suggest that the caller recheck the number and dial again. So someone has called you, and suppose I have called you, and if I say, hello, is this Ajit or is this Rahul? Is this Raj? Okay, and if you are not Raj, or if you are not the person whom I have called you, so what will you call? What will you say to me? You will say, please, Mr. XYZ, recheck the number and dial it again. It is not the number of person whom you want to call. Please recheck the number and dial again. आपण म्हणतो ना, तुम्ही तुमचा नंबर चेक करा आणि पुन्हा फोन करा, डायल करा, की तो तुमचा म्हणजे तुम्हाला जो व्यक्ती पाहिजे बोलण्यासाठी तो नाहीये असं थोडक्यात. If the caller is trying to reach a destination that you are familiar with or have an idea about, do your best to find the number and assist the caller in transferring the call. Right. Suppose one of the person has called you and has asked if you know Rahul, right? Suppose if you know the Raj, and you want to help him to find out the Raj, at that time you may provide the number of Raj and Raj, but make sure that you should confirm you should take the prior permission of the Raj. Do not share his number. Oftentimes, someone has called, oftentimes we receive the call who ask the number of other person, and we directly share the number of that person. Okay, it should, this habit should be stopped. Okay, if someone has asked the contact number of someone else, then your prime duty is that you should confirm the person of that person and convey him that Mr. XYZ has called me and he was asking or she was asking for your phone number. What could I do? Could I share your number with him or not, or him, her or not? So you should take a permission of the that person before sharing his or her number, personal contact with the other person. So this thing should be taken into consideration. Angry customers. Oftentimes we face angry customers, right? Do not allow yourself to get angry when guest shouts. Okay. So suppose you are working at reception and you had a call, and if that person, if guest is angry with you, he might have not get a proper facilities in the hotel or at the place, okay, and he might be in the angry mood. At that time, what will you do? Will you be in angry mood while speaking with that person? No, you will not. You will ask yourself that you should. You will not allow yourself to get angry when the guest shouts at you. If other person shouts at you, you will not leave your place. You will speak only in a calm and quiet, or respectfully and in peaceful manner. Empathize. Empathy. Express regret for the situation. For example, I am sorry for the inconveniences. Suppose someone has called you and asked for the help, and if you are not able to help that person, then you will say, I am sorry for inconveniences. I could not help you out. Okay, right? Even though it is not your duty to help him or help her. Okay, but as a telephonic conversation etiquette, you will say, I am sorry for inconveniences. I could not connect your call with XYZ in this way. Find a way to agree with their circumstances. For example, I understand what you are going through. I would be upset too if that happened to me. Okay, if someone has called you and was very angry with you regarding some delivery, okay. And at that time, suppose you have received a very, damaged delivery from the Amazon, okay. What will you do? You will call to the customer care of Amazon and will speak in angry mood, right? You as a employee of the Amazon, how will you speak with that customer? You will say, I understand what you are going through. I would be upset too if that happened to me. I understand what the condition you are going through. Had I been on your place, I would have been upset too. But I will try at my level best to answer your question or to solve your problem. Okay, you will not speak in a shouting mood or in a shout. Guests suggest alternatives for handling the problem that you have the authority and take responsibility for providing answer to the customer. If someone has called you for the help, if you are not able to help him, you will suggest some solution or will provide some alternatives. Okay, next. Telephonic etiquettes. Just a minute. Okay, point number 8, telephonic etiquette. Think through exactly what you plan to say and discuss before you place a call. आता पहिला आपण सम टेलिकेट आता टेलिफोनिक इटिकेट्स काय असतात बघू. व्हॉट वी विल बी लुकिंग अबाउट, वी विल बी थिंकिंग अबाउट हाऊ कुड वी यु नो आन्सर द क्वेश्चन, आन्सर द फोन कॉल अँड व्हॉट वुड बी द टेलिफोनिक टेलिफोन इटिकेट्स फॉर दॅट. फॉर एक्झाम्पल, थिंक थ्रू एक्झॅक्टली व्हॉट यू प्लॅन टू से अँड डिस्कस बिफोर यू प्लेस अ कॉल, राईट. म्हणजे बिफोर you could place a call or if you before you could call someone else, you please make sure that you have prepared about what you want to say to that person. You will not call in a van, you will not call unprepared. Okay, oftentimes what we do, we just pick up phone, we just pick up phone and make a call, make a phone call to someone else without knowing what you want to speak with that person. It should not be the case. First of all, you make sure that you have to share these points with that person, and you will take only 2 or 3 minutes for that reason, and then you should make a phone call. As we prepared for the examination, we must prepare for the phone call too. Okay, by taking into cause and pros, by taking into the situation, by taking into the what would be the situation, what I in situ, if that situation comes to me, how I will be handle that situation, all these things should be taken into consideration. Always identify yourself at the beginning of all the calls. First of all, identify yourself whether you are okay in answering the question or receiving the phone call. Always speak into a telephone receiver with an even and low tone of voice. High pitch will sound like shouting. What we do observe in everyday life, if oftentimes we do have a question in mind, if that person is really speaking through the phone, okay, he is shouting in a such a way that he, as if he is speaking to someone else instead of speaking on a phone. म्हणजे असे एवढ्या आवाजात तो मोठ्याने बोलत असतो किंवा ती मोठ्याने बोलत असते, फोनवर बोलते, हेच आपल्याला प्रॉब्लेम वाटतो कधी कधी. म्हणजे काय करावं लागेल, व्हॉट यू हॅव टू डू हिअर, यू विल हॅव टू यूज व्हेरी लो टोन ऑफ व्हॉइस. पीच, हाय पीच विल साऊंड लाईक अ शाउटिंग. जर मोठ्या आवाजात बोलला तर तो मोठा शाउटिंग होईल ते. बी सेन्सिटिव्ह टू द टोन ऑफ युअर व्हॉइस. Be sensitive to the tone of your voice. Your tone of voice should be soft, it should be lower, and it should be respectful, or it should be courteous. It should not be a arrogant. Just going to share the screen. Teja se, where? Your screen ka photo that me. Just going to stop sharing screen. Okay, see, especially when leaving message, speak clearly and slowly. When you want to leave the message, please speak clearly and slowly. Build a habit of always turning off your cell phone ringer when entering a meeting, restaurant, theater, training class, or the other place. Okay, what is the habit? What would be the good habit? you should turn off your phone call or you should keep your phone call on silent mode before you enter in a meeting, before you enter in a restaurant, before you enter in the theater, before you enter in the training class or other places where you are asked to observe the silence. You are asked to maintain the silence. Okay. And what we do, we exactly put our phone on a ringing mode on this in such a situation. Okay, this is our habit. You should get control over it. Do not allow interruptions to occur during the conversations. So if you are speaking with someone, you will not allow any interruptions frequently while speaking with the another. Do not allow yourself to be distracted by other activities while speaking on a phone. If you are speaking on a phone, you will give your 100% concentration to the first that caller instead of doing other business. So do not distract or do not disturb by others. General telephone etiquette tips. Pick the phone at worst at third rings. Okay, I have told you that. Speak pleasantly using basic phrases of courtesy. May I help you? Thank you. You are welcome. Suppose when you will receive phone for the first time, you will say, hello, XYZ, good morning. How can I help you? And then when the phone call is going to end, you will say, thank you. You are welcome. Please keep calling in this way. Smile on a phone in order to have pleasant voice or tone. Oftentimes we think that why should I give a smile when I am speaking on the phone? Whether that person is looking at me? No, there is no video call exactly. Still, if you want to have a pleasant voice, you should have a smile on your face. Otherwise, you could not bring a pleasant voice. Okay, pleasant voice means ekdam mrudu aawaz manje kind of shant aawaz. Okay, manjur manto jala aawaz. If you want to bring a pleasant voice, you should have a smile on your face. Otherwise, you won't be able to bring a pleasant voice. Sound alert and active. Let not your voice sound lazy, tired, bored, and disinterested. One must keep into consideration one thing that when you are speaking on a phone, your sound should be very active, prompt, it should be positive, and it should not be rude, bored, disinterested, and lazy, tired. But tumhi jar tired shabdat bolla mhanje khup thakla asa dakhavla, khup arrogant, rude, bored, disinterested asa dakhavla tar te samorchala bolnyachi ichcha honarach nahi tumcha barobar. He will not be happy to speak with you, or he would not be continue to speak with you. ठीक है. Therefore, you will have to bring a smile on your face. You please keep your laziness, tiredness, rudeness, boredness, and disinterestedness away from you. Be polite or courteous to all calls, irrespective of circumstances. Whatever the circumstances it may be, whatever the situation it may be, if someone has called you, you will have to receive the phone call. And if you are not able to call for a longer time, you should at least say, hello, Mr. XYZ, I am in a work, I am busy right now, I will call you back after some time, and or I will call you back after 1 hour. So after 1 hour, you will have to call the same person again. Okay. Do not slam the phone or cut off abruptly. Do not slam or phone cut off abruptly. You do not cut the phone, you know, in the mid. Okay, it may create a misunderstanding too. Avoid slangs. Do not eat, sip a drink, chew gum while on a phone. When you are speaking on a phone, you will not eat something. You will not eat anything. You will not drink, and you will not chew a gum while on a phone. What happens if you are eating something and you are speaking at the same time on the phone? While eating, you will take some pause and you will not be able to speak with the other person. So it does mean that you use more importance to the food rather than that person. You use more importance to the drink and gum rather than that person.
Okay, and because of eating, drinking, or chewing a gum in the call, it might, you know, create some disturbances in the communication too. Okay, when transferring calls, whether incoming or outgoing, introduce both party to each other. When you are transferring call to someone, you as a transferer of call, you will introduce both the party to each other, and then you will leave your conversation. Do not keep the caller on hold for more than 30 or 60 seconds. See, there is a variation 60-30, but not more than one. Without communicating your efforts. When ending your call, ensure there are no unfinished business.
See, before you end your call, make sure that all the businesses of the caller has been finished. Unacceptable phrases and acceptable phrases. See. We could see two phrases, two slides over here. What kind of a phrases you will not use? What kind of a phrases you will use? You can't say you will have to wait if someone has called you. And you can't say directly that you will have to wait for some time. Yeah, I do not know. No, we can't. Such kind of negative words should not be used by you. If someone has called you, you will not use such kind of words. Acceptable phrases are thank you, I will check, or I will see. Okay. Atapa, take a minute. I do not know. In the unacceptable phrases, third sentence is I do not know. If someone has asked, called you and asked the address of particular person, if you do not know, though you don't know, you will not say I do not know. You will only say, okay, I will try at my level best to search it out. Okay. तुम्ही काय म्हणणार जर तुम्हाला फोन केला आणि विचारला कुठला पत्ता, तर तुम्हाला माहित नसला तरी तुम्ही म्हणायचं की मी तुम्हाला चौकशी करून सांगेल. पण यू कॅन्ट से आय डू नॉट नो डिरेक्टली, वी कॅन्ट से. इन्स्टेड ऑफ यू कॅन से आय विल चेक और आय विल सी. थँक यू. येस मिस्टर सर. वन मोमेंट प्लीज, आय विल फाइंड आउट. इफ समवन हॅज आस्क यू इफ देर इज अ पेन ड्राइव्ह ऑन युअर फोन, on your cupboard, on your table, and if you don't know if it is over there, you will say, please give me some time, I will call you back if it is there. One moment please, I will find out. Yes, you may. In this way, see, here are the some expressions that I have brought for you. See, when you call the company, open the call will be answered by secretary. See the situation. When you call the company, open the call will be answered by the secretary. Secretary will say, good morning, ABC Systems. How may I help you? When you call to some office, okay, there is phone attendant. Okay. And that secretary or that phone attendant will receive the phone and will say, good morning, ABC Systems. Instead of calling, sharing her name, she is saying ABC system means that she is speaking from ABC system counter. Okay. Good morning. I am speaking from ABC system counters. Instead of saying this, she is saying ABC systems. How may I help you? How to ask, speak with someone callers? आता तुम्ही फोन केलाय त्या सेक्रेटरीला. ओके, आणि सेक्रेटरी काय म्हणते, गुड मॉर्निंग एबीसी सिस्टम्स, हाऊ मे आय हेल्प यू. यू विल से, कॉलर मीन्स यू, हॅलो, आय वुड लाईक टू स्पीक विथ मिस्टर जोन्स प्लीज. ज्यावेळेस वेन सेक्रेटरी विल आस्क यू हाऊ मे आय हेल्प यू, यू विल से हॅलो, आय वुड लाईक टू स्पीक विथ मिस्टर जोन्स प्लीज. कॉलर काय म्हणेल, हॅलो कॉलर, डबल झालंय, लेट इट. Hello, could I speak to Mr. Jones in sales, please? Hello, could you put me through Mr. Jones, please? See, there are three sentences used over here. You may use, hello, I would like to speak with Mr. Jones, please. You may say, hello, I would like to speak Mr. I could I speak with speak to Mr. Jones in sales, please. In sales means the Mr. Jones, who is working in a sales department, I would like to speak with him. Right. How will you say, hello, could I speak to Mr. Jones in a sales, please? Or, hello, could you put me through Mr. Jones, please? आपण म्हणतो ना मला जोन्सशी बोलायचं, तुम्ही त्यांना कनेक्ट करू देता का तो फोन, तर तसं तुम्ही काय म्हणता, हॅलो कुड यू पुट मी थ्रू मिस्टर जोन्स प्लीज. सपोज इफ यू हॅव कॉल्ड युअर फ्रेंड अँड इफ द फादर ऑफ युअर फ्रेंड हॅज रिसिव्ड युअर फोन अँड इफ ही हॅज सेड हॅलो मिस्टर एक्स वाय झेड हाऊ मे आय हेल्प यू, यू मे से हॅलो कुड यू पुट मी थ्रू मिस्टर कुड यू पुट मी थ्रू Ajay, please, in this way. The secretary will also ask who you are, who are you? Secretary, tumhala kay mhanto, could I ask who is calling, please? Who is speaking? Pahila sentence kay, how may I help you? And second sentence tense kay, who is speaking or who is speaking or who is calling, please? So how do you identify yourself, caller? It's Joe Bloggs from Admiral Computing. It's Joe Bloggs from Admiral Computing, or this is Joe Bloggs from Admiral Computing. But it's Joe means, let's say he is a boy or he is a man. Why it is used it's over here? Because it is telephonic etiquette, using this is, it is before the personal noun. Secretary, could I ask the purpose of call, please? Tyanantar ti kay mhanu shakte, why are you calling? What is the purpose of calling? Secretary, may I ask what is it about? Secretary will say, may I ask what is it about? How to explain why you are calling? Tumhi explain kasa karnar calling ka kela mhanun. Caller will say, yes, of course, I am calling to discuss invoice. Actually, I have called Mr. XYZ in order to discuss invoice. Invoice means kai tari bill vagera asa na company cha, te discuss karayche. Caller came, yes, of course, I met Mr. Jones at IT conference in the London last week and he asked me to call him back. And tumhi kay mhanu shakta, tyala answer kay deu shakta, tar yes, of course, I met Mr. Jones in the IT conference in London and he has asked me to call him back at when he will return to the company or home, in this way. Okay, the secretary came on telling you the person is not available. And the secretary came on ki baba to vyakti ahe ka nahi ki ata tumhi kay mhanla ki actually Mr. Jones I met him in the IT conference held in London and Mr. Jones has asked me to call him back. Mag ata the secretary kay karel, call Mr. Bloggs ahet ka baktil and tyanantar kay mhanteil, he is in a meeting at the moment. He is out for the lunch right now. He is out of the office today. He is not available today. He is on the business trip this week. He is on the holiday, or he is on the vacation. Holiday and vacation, two words. If you use holiday, it is British English. If you use vacation, it is American English. It depends on you which language, which English you are following. Then how to ask when person will return? व्यक्ती केव्हा येईल हे विचारायचं असेल तर, caller, do you know when he will be back, please? Do you know when he will be available, please? When would be convenient? What would be the convenient time for me to call back, please? I'll be coming. So in this way you could use telephonic conversation. If you have any problem, please feel free to ask me. Okay, do you have any problem? Okay, see, tomorrow we are going to engage the test for English and it will be held at 10:30 tomorrow and the remaining communication regarding the test will be conveyed to you through a group, okay, on WhatsApp group, okay. Mr. Patil sir will be writing a message to you on the WhatsApp regarding the details of the test, okay, for tomorrow's test. When tomorrow we will have our English test. Okay, thank you.
Thanks a lot, Pandra sir. One more important announcement is here that
interaction and
There will be batch-wise interaction with your mentors. You have to remain present for the same. And the thing is that tomorrow is going to be a big day as induction program among all the days, because tomorrow one institute, Maharashtra Chamber of Commerce, Industries and Agriculture, is arranging complimentary induction program for you people only online directly from Mumbai. So it is mandatory for each student to attend this session right from minute one. The program you have to join. So tomorrow morning I will be giving you the message regarding the same. You have to register on that with your valid email ID, and you will be getting the link of the meeting on that email. And again, the platform will be covered by that organization only. That organization is working along with Jugad Bhanda, and for that our staff members as well as all the students must remain present wholeheartedly. You have to alert for all the 2 hours, and after that there will be a small test, and then you will be eligible to get certificates from the institution. So for getting certificates is going to be a thing of really worth, and for that you have to remain alert for the entire time. So tomorrow in the morning also I am going to make announcement about the same, but this is for your kind information. So with this, I say that this session is over, and next session will be conducted by your mentors and class teachers.